Hi, I'm Mary Harrell for Tan Books. It is starting. Get ready. The countdown for Christmas is already on. And just in time for that, take one of the most popular Christmas songs of all time and show it how it can teach us not just about random birds and pipers piping, but truly about God's lavish love for us and really the gifts that our true love gives us every day. That's the goal of the new collaboration between Katie Warner and artist Elizabeth Zelasko in Tan's newest release for Christmas, My True Love Gave to Me, a catechism for the 12 days of Christmas. And Elizabeth is joining us today to talk about this beautiful project. Elizabeth, thanks for joining me.
Yeah, thank you. This is so fun. This is great. It's great to be here to talk about this book.
We're so glad. I know a lot of people are very excited about this book. I think kids' books at Christmas are so important and always excited to have a new release for one. So tell us how long you've been an artist and what drew you to creating religious art versus more secular forms, and really just what's your background here?
Yeah, so I've been an artist my whole life. I have identified as an artist. I was in special art classes in kindergarten. My mom's a painter. Her dad was a painter. It was just always something that was very nurtured in our house. But yeah, I would say for the past 20 years, I've been a professional artist, working with Catholic publishers and illustrators and my goodness, museums. I've just been really, the work has been so fulfilling. So I went to art school in New York City. I was born and raised in New Jersey, so if you're an artist, your brain's just kind of like New York, right? Like you have to just, that's the place you go to be an artist is New York City. So I got into School of Visual Arts in New York back in the day. And I was just very, I was young. I was coming back to my faith. I had actually born and raised Catholic, kind of left the faith for a little while, and thank God came back to it before college, which can be a really difficult time to lose your faith. So I was a little disappointed, nothing against School of Visual Arts, but just the modern way of teaching art in general, I found to be very lacking in instruction. So I stayed at School of Visual Arts for 2 years, and by the grace of God, found iconography. So that's a little bit of a longer story, but I came across an icon in Wisconsin, of all places, and I was like, if somebody did this, there must be a way to learn how to do it, right? Like that's kind of the logical, like, where can I learn how to do this? And sure enough, there was a school in New York City, so I was already there. And I left School of Visual Arts and started learning Russian Orthodox iconography, and it just blew my mind. It was kind of this coming together of the art that I just deeply loved, and I really wanted to be an artist, and so it was that art aspect, right? And then it was religion, which I was totally falling in love with God all over again, falling in love with my religion all over again, and just the technical educational aspect of it. Like these people were teaching me technique, they were teaching me history, they were teaching me how to use paint in a very particular way. That's been handed down throughout the generations, and I was just swimming in beauty and theology. It was so good.
That ties right in with when you look at this book, the pictures are iconic. They look like you could just, X-Acto knife a page out and put it on your wall. They look like icons.
Which I guess you can do. You probably could do that if you want. Buy two copies and then cut one of them out.
Yeah, we recommend you buy all the copies you want. Put them everywhere in your house. Absolutely. But how did you collaborate with Katie to say this art is going to look like icons? How did you come up with this method with her of saying what the words would be and what the images and these very icon-esque illustrations would look like? What was that process?
So Katie Warner is an absolute gem of a person. I'm sure that you've spoken to her before, but she's so lovely, she's so delightful, and she was very hands-off. She was just sort of like, Liz, I love your work. Just run with it. And that's as an artist, that's my favorite kind of commission, is just the freedom of let me just see what comes out. And so she had all the words already and the layout obviously of the 12 days. And I just kind of let the Holy Spirit lead the way. It was like if I just sat with each one and prayed. I wanted it to be I wanted it to kind of come across as like an illuminated manuscript, because these things are, they're illuminated. This is the truths of our faith. They are illuminations, so to speak, in our lives. And I wanted it to have that feel of something that you can, like the Book of Hours, like you just sit and you can pray with each image, and you can really just, as a little kid, the Christmas books that I loved were the ones that I could just sit with one page and just pay attention to all the little details. Kids love that stuff. They love to kind of find these little nuggets in the pages. And so I tried to have that come across in each page too. But yeah, the overall look of the book, it kind of mentions visually lots of different kinds of Catholic art, which I'm all about celebrating, because I studied Orthodox iconography, but I also do classical art. I do religious art. I do sacred art in the Roman Rite as well. I wanted to celebrate all the Catholic art. And so I think you can kind of feel that vibe throughout the whole book. Did I think I answered that question?
Well, you totally did. And it's, I love that the book does not dumb down the content for children, that you easily have a parent reading this book and could also be totally absorbed saying, that is an absolutely stunningly beautiful illustration to go with this. It is accessible for children, but not dumbed down at all. It's one of the very special things about it. One of the other really neat things about your book is that included in the back is a note from the illustrator, a note from the artist, and that you talk about each image and the imagery that you use, the hidden tools in each piece, the meaning of each piece. What was that like for you as an artist to be able to include an explanation, a guide to all the beautiful art you created?
Yeah, deeply gratifying. That's so nice. You know, it was a really nice opportunity to have a couple pages to kind of hash that out. And it's helpful too, because some of this stuff, you know, I mentioned, I have one page, it's on the third day of Christmas. I mentioned Botticelli's work, and I'm sure a lot of people know about his work, but some people might not. So it's like, well, how did I come to that conclusion to use that image for this page? And that's all explained in the back. And I really feel like it adds a level of richness, especially for the adult as a sort of catechist tool, so to speak, for explaining each page to their children and sitting with them and bringing them deeper into it.
I think that's very important for parents in trying to, maybe they don't get the significance of the five scrolls of the Old Testament.
Right.
What a great time to brush up on that and be able to say, I know where we can find that answer in the back.
Right, right. We have very good, faithful Jewish friends, and she helped me with all of the Hebrew that's in the book. So it was cross-checked many times, and I had to make adjustments too. She was like, don't put that there, put it here. You know, it was really, mm-hmm. really helpful.
Yeah. So you mentioned that the Old Testament ones, what are some of the other pages from the book or images that stand out to you as your favorites in creating and then seeing on the page when you held the book the first time?
Yeah. There's something about it's the Last Supper scene. I mean, there's so many that I love. I really feel strongly about each one, but there's definitely a couple, right? That, I mean, you can't help but have a little bit of a tug on your heart towards a particular one. I loved the Last Supper scene is sort of a traditional icon. And it's just, I think it's like the way that Christ is looking at the viewer is so, it's so loving. Like you're kind of sitting at the table also in this icon. And you can see to the lower left, there's Judas who's kind of in the shadows, but he's kind of clenching the money bag, and it's like you don't want to be sitting there, you know? But he's mentioned, you know, it's the 11 good true apostles. But yeah, it was beautiful to set the table, so to speak, with the traditional Passover food, and then the Eucharist, to place the Eucharist on there too was really, really special. And it's really glaring, you can kind of see it, it's the just that circle right there, the bread.
It's beautiful. It's just beautiful. You mentioned your own childhood and Christmas and books you used to love to sit with. Do you have any books in particular from your own childhood that still now that your own kids look at or that were particularly formative? And if you had had a book like this in your childhood at Christmas, how would have it had impacted your celebration of the birth of Christ, or how you would imagine it, how significant it was to you in the season.
We definitely had a lot of religious icons and paintings in our house growing up. I'm sure my mom would correct me, but I don't remember specifically religious Christmas books. They were more Santa based, you know, and it still was a beautiful thing, but I think this would have been so helpful to really, there's enough secular stuff out there to feed us for a millennial, but this is just really specific to our faith, and it's really a celebration of beauty and the art that belongs to our church, and to help you through the Christmas season. So I think that it is really, it's unique. I know that my kids are going to love this year. Growing up, I mean, there was a book, The Night Before Christmas, by Douglas Goslin, I think. Douglas Goslin. It was a 70s book. I think it was 1975. And it was, the illustrations were kind of what I was saying in the beginning. That's what comes to mind. Like when you sit with a book and you're able to sit with one page. And there was this one scene where it was like the kids were all nestled in their beds, but it was a scene of their bedroom, and you could just see like the toys that were left on the floor, and one kid sleeping with like the blanket pulled all the way up, or another kid has like their foot dangling. It was just so, so intricate. And I think that's what I loved, and what I kind of wanted to bring into this book was that just all the little things that you can find, all the little intricacies. And that's just lovely. But that book has always stayed with me. We have that one. A non-Christmassy book, because anything Tommy DiPaolo ever did was a huge influence on me. I mean, that man, anything he touched, I was just enthralled with, especially the Clown of God. I have that in my studio. I have a picture of that framed. I did buy one copy just to cut out the one picture and put it on my wall. It's Mary holding the child who's holding the golden ball. That story has been a part of my life, my whole life. Yeah, and it has always deeply, deeply touched me. The Clown of God, highly recommend. It's so good. It's so good.
Oh my goodness, it makes me cry. I can't get through it.
Oh, I know. Please. I could like conjure tears just kind of like thinking about it. But I think that's what we all are supposed to be. Like, I think that was inspiring for me. It's like I want to be, you know, kind of a fool for Christ, so to speak. You know, you just want to you want to live and die doing that. You want to you know, give this joy back to the child of Christ. It's so. Ah, so good. Yeah. That book had a huge impact on me, though.
You and Katie called this a catechism. You didn't call this a picture book. You didn't call this a song book. It's a catechism. Tell us why you chose that word.
Yeah, it's exactly what it is. I mean, it literally goes through all of these truths of our faith, and it leads us through each one with the you know, the words and with the illustrations. Like it really is something to walk through. And it's just such a good, I really feel like it's going to be a good teaching tool this season. I really do. I'm very, really hopeful for that. I'm hopeful for the parents who will, you know, read this to their kids. And I'm hopeful for the kids that will sit and read it on their own and just spend time with each page. That has always been my prayer through all of it. And yeah, I hope that it really bears fruit for people this season and seasons to come. I think what's beautiful about this is that it's not overly Christmassy, if that makes sense. It's a Christmas book, but I, you know, there's nothing in there that screams Christmas trees, presents, no Santa images are in there. So I think it's something that can stay out all year. I really do. And I kind of, that was my intention behind it. Yeah. I don't even know if there's a snowflake in here. Yeah.
That is a wonderful point, that it's not like it's an Advent book per se, or even a 12 days of Christmas strictly, you know, in the octave or something like that. It's not that. It really could be a catechetical tool year round. Excellent point. Well, again, the book is My True Love Gave to Me, a Catechism for the 12 Days of Christmas. Ask about it at your local Catholic bookstore, or you can find it right here, of course, at tanbooks.com. Elizabeth, congratulations on a beautiful project. What a wonderful thing to be able to give to families in this season. And like you said, around. Yep. Congratulations.
Thank you for doing this. Thank you so much. Thanks for having me on today.